Western Ghats, some of the most welcome heat relief in India, rising like an impassable bulwark of evergreen and deciduous tangle from north of Mumbai to the tip of Tamil Nadu. India's 1,600 km long Western Ghats is a mountain chain that covers an area of around 160,000 square kilometer and has been added to the list of UNESCO World Heritage Site. It is recognized as one of the world's 8 hottest hotspots of biological diversity. Older than the Himalaya mountains, the Western Ghats represents geomorphic features of immense importance with a unique biophysical and ecological processes. The forests include some of the best representatives of non-equatorial tropical evergreen forests in the world. Present day, biodiversity has evolved and adapted to the climate and the soils of the area. Within the tropical environment and the rich natural resources, a variety of mixed forests have sprung up along the Western Ghats. In them, one can find species that have originated in different climates but have adapted to the tropical monsoon climate. Some of the species are present in specialized and restricted niches to form a rich endemic population that defines the Western Ghats as a biodiversity hotspot. It supports the life of 7,402 species of flowering plants, 1,814 species of non-flowering plants, 139 mammal species, 508 bird species, 179 amphibian species, 6,000 insect species, and 290 freshwater fish species. With a large number of endemic flora and fauna, the Western Ghat is unique in many ways. Home to thousands of animal species, including at least 325 globally threatened species. Out of that, 129 are classified as vulnerable, 145 as endangered, and 51 as critically endangered. Many are endemic species, especially in amphibian, reptilian, and fish classes. 32 threatened species of mammals live in the Western Ghats. It is very important to conserve the Western Ghats, which is rich in biodiversity, and that can give us an insurance policy for life. Safeguard the Western Ghats to our own survival.
Of our wildlife week. We have Madhura Nifadkar with us today, and we are going to have an amazing session, I'm sure of it. Before I begin introducing her, I would like to again introduce our hub and all the NGOs that are helping us. So to all of us who have joined our entire wildlife week from today, we have a live session which happened yesterday, and we'll be sharing that link with all the registered participants soon. Global Shapers Panjim Hub is part of a community that was formed. It's a baby of World Economic Forum and was founded in 2011 by Professor Klaus Schwab. Our community consists of more than 7,000 members who have been working across the world in 171 countries. We have around 370 hubs, which are working tirelessly everywhere on different issues such as climate change, education and employment, technological advancement, which is currently called as the fourth industrial revolution, about mental health, physical health, as well as the recent COVID-19 response. Global Shapers Panjim Hub was formed in 2014 by Talula De Silva, and we have a group of more than 20 people who has been working in Panjim City as well as in different parts of Goa on various projects. If you want, we have much more information, and we are currently recruiting youngsters to be part of our hub. The information to contact us you can find at the end of this live session. We are also partnering with three NGOs which are working in Goa. The first one is Study and Awareness of Wildlife and Environment. It was started in 2013 in Ponda, and they have organized different awareness programs in schools and colleges through which they have tried to make students aware of their own surroundings, the wildlife which is there in our surroundings, which people hardly notice. So this is the work that they are doing. They also have a nature information center in Walpur, in a really old house. So you can definitely contact them as well when you want to know more about their work. We are partnering with Foundation for Environment Research and Conservation, which is an NGO as well. It is mainly based in Wasco, but all its members are spread across Goa. And they are engaged in several activities which are related to environmental research, awareness and conservation. Madhura is part of FERC, and I hope she will briefly touch upon their work as well. So they consist of professionals which are working in various fields such as solid waste management, education, biodiversity research, and geospatial technology, which we are going to learn about today. Ecotourism is also a part of their entire endeavor. They mainly aim to promote social and environmental awareness and conservation activities. We have also partnered with Goa Bird Conservation Network, which roots back to 2010, which started with documenting different birds which are there in Goa and then focusing on their conservation, spreading awareness about birds, and overall taking up bird walks and different avenues related to bird watching in Goa. The entire GBCN actually started as a chapter of India Bird Conservation Network, and since its inception, its membership has just grown. So you can also be a part of Global Shapers. Along with Global Shapers, you can join these three NGOs which are working in various fields. Now I would turn to introduce Madhura, and I talked about her so fondly because I've known her for quite some time, and she has worked on so many different areas. And if you want to know about her work, I'm sure that today's presentation is not going to be enough, and she has so much knowledge to give that you could spend hours talking with her. Madhura is currently doing her postdoctoral research in Azim Premji University, and she is working on investigating land cover changes in various locations where forest rights were granted to tribal people. This work is going on in Maharashtra. She has done her PhD in ecology from A3 in Manipal PhD program in interdisciplinary ecology. She has also worked in this entire field of mapping diverse ecological phenomena and the remote sensing techniques for last 15 years, and is going on in the same direction for quite some time. She has created different maps for citizen science portals, and we'll learn about that further on in her presentation today. Her work also involves applications of geospatial technologies related to wildlife habitat conservation and similar works with ecologists, and finding out landscape level solutions for local challenges that we face. All of this work is going to be structured down for anyone to understand, because we are focusing for a lot of students and people who are willing to join a career or a path which then leads to wildlife conservation. Our entire focus during this Wildlife Week celebration is to inspire youth to take up a career or a path that would ultimately end up in wildlife and ecological conservation, or something which on similar lines. All the people who are going to talk in our sessions are from various fields, different aspects of wildlife conservation, and they can definitely help you. So please join on our other sessions as well. Now I would like to introduce Ninoshka, who is here. She and I are hosting this festival. I'm Brunmayi Thakur, and I would now turn directly to Madhura to start with her presentation.
Thank you, Brunmayi, for such a generous introduction, and thank you for saying all these nice things about me. I'm very privileged and honored to have been a part of this Wildlife Week celebration, commemorative celebration presentations. I'm going to speak mostly from a technical perspective, and I'm hoping that this will inspire some of the students who are joining in to actually take this up as a career, because it's a very rewarding career, and you can help in wildlife to contribute to wildlife conservation. So let me start sharing my screen.
To all those viewers who are listening with us, please make sure that you have questions ready. At the end of this presentation, Madhura would love to answer them. They are there. You can share them in the live chat of our session.
Yeah. So I represent Goa Foundation for Environment Research and Conservation, and we are an NGO based in Vasco, as Mrinmayi told you. Today I'm going to speak to you about geospatial mapping as an aid to wildlife conservation, and I'd like to start with this cartoon, these couple cartoons that Rohan Chakravarti has on his site. The first one is showing you how a poor elephant's migration route has been destroyed by humans to occupy it with a golf course. And the other one is talking about how a poor tiger has no choices but to go into the river because the only options offered to it are either a coal mine or a highway across the park. So not giving it any opportunity to actually reside where it would want to. So this brings me to, you know, why do we want to do wildlife conservation? I mean, if all of you are listening, all those of you who are listening to this talk and this series of talks, I don't need to emphasize that wildlife conservation is important, because I guess you are tuned into that. But I just wanted to briefly speak about how they have a right to live on this earth as much as we do. They bring multiple direct benefits to us. They maintain ecological balance. They add to our quality of life, aesthetic, emotional, recreational, all of this, as is really evident in the recent Save More Land campaign. If some of you in Goa have been following it, there's so much of art and music which has been inspired by the wildlife and the nature over there. So they add more to our life than we can actually imagine. So let's look at why is mapping important for wildlife conservation? Wildlife really needs space to live. As you have just seen, the elephant and the tiger need a space to live, breed, and grow. They need space to interact and coexist with each other and provide a balance. Maps allow for this. They allow for understanding what the current spatial pattern is of the land. They allow for understanding and measuring flows and interactions amongst these elements of the spatial pattern. And they also allow for a future management action depending on what exists where. And thus, they allow for creating a harmonious environment for all the elements of nature. So let's look at what is geospatial technology. Geo, as many of you must know, is in Latin, means earth, which includes land, water, and air. And technology it includes tools and techniques. So geospatial technology is that which enables the mapping of the earth, its resources, its inhabitants, and an analysis of all of these and their interactions with each other. So the most important component of this geospatial technology is the spatial location. So maps are key. They are the beginning, the middle, and the end of end result or outputs of the application of geospatial technology. So now let's look at what it includes. And here's, I've just listed briefly what all it includes. So firstly, it includes remote sensing or satellite imaging taking images of the earth using aerial photographs. It includes GIS or geographical information systems. It includes global positioning systems or GPS, as everyone must now be quite aware of. It also includes cartography, the science and art of map making, because it really, the kind of maps you produce and outputs that you produce really changes your worldview of things, and you'll see that in a bit. And today, as we speak in 2020, drone mapping and monitoring has also become a very, very important component of geospatial technology, and who knows what else is coming up front. So now I'm going to speak a little bit about each of these in brief. Remote sensing is the science of sensing remotely. That means your eyes are actually remote sensors, because you're looking at something and you're understanding it without touching it. So coming without touching anything, you come in, you are able to sense it. That is remote sensing. So in the technical term, it includes satellite imagery. It includes aerial photos and now also drone images. So satellite images capture photographs of the earth from about 30,000 kilometers above the surface of the earth. And they capture this information in different wavelength bands of the electromagnetic spectrum. So reflectance of all the objects from the earth are captured in photographs or satellite images. And these images, although, need some processing by a trained expert who can understand the satellite imagery and extract information from it more than what is visible to the naked eye. So this picture on the right that you see, the top image is a satellite image, and the bottom one is a derived land cover map from that for this is a location in Gujarat, the Banni grasslands in Kutch. So that's the remote sensing in a nutshell. Now let's look at some visuals. So this is a map of Goa with just showing the boundary. Here is a satellite image taken sometime in 2013. As many of you can know, all the eastern side of the state of Goa is covered with the forests. And here is an elevation map, also taken derived from a satellite, from satellite data, looking at the different hills in Goa. And here is a Google Earth image, which is also derived from satellite images, from very high resolution satellite imagery. Okay, so the next thing is our aerial photos and maps. So here is a picture of an aerial photo and a map. So an aerial photo is just an image, like a photo, taken by an aircraft. And it used to be very common earlier. It actually evolved during the World War II, when flights were being flown for defense purposes. And the image on your right is a map. So what's the difference? And a map is a line drawing. It has representations of different features on the ground. And it is a representation to scale. It is not the exact thing, but it is a representation of the surface of the land. Then here's a map. Here's an image taken by a drone. So drones are instruments which are flown a few meters above the ground. And this is a picture taken of an agricultural landscape. So you can do amazing things with drones nowadays. Some of you may have seen drones flying in wedding receptions and taking pictures of people. So this is a good way of using drone mapping for, maybe drones can be used for mapping heights of trees or deciding the alignment of a road or some planning stuff like that. Which leads me to the next geospatial technology, which is geographical information systems. So GIS includes all these components, which you can see to the left. It includes the hardware, which means the mouse, the computer, the GPS. It includes data, which is spatial data and textual or statistical data, all kinds of data. It includes the software. It includes people, the analysts or the people who actually do the GIS analysis. And it also includes the methods. And all these come together to produce outputs, which are maps. Here is a typical view of a GIS geographical information system screen. So you would have a map. Here you can see on the map, the graphics are the protected areas in Goa adjoining to the ones in Karnataka. And then there is a database management system, which is a table, which has all the information written in text. And you can perform different kinds of queries on that and derive information or make maps. Next, we come to cartography. So cartography is the art of map making, and it communicates geographic information. Any map has to have proper arrangement of all the elements in it, all the title, the map itself, what it is trying to convey. And all of this together, the appropriate mix of it will only convey the proper information. Let's have some fun. I'm going to show you a couple maps which you may not expect to see. These are cartographic representations. They are called as cartograms. Cartograms are actually, as you can see, these are maps of the world, and they depict different variables. So they depict the size and shape of the land is bulging depending on the size or the amount of that particular variable. So on the top left, you can see the map which shows energy depletion. Depletion means removal from its source without being replaced. So you can see the green of the Middle East, show bulging up, where a lot of removal is happening of petroleum, and it's not being replaced. Then the map here shows spending on public health. So you can see the developed countries like the US, Europe, and Japan have spent on health quite a lot, whereas countries such as those in Africa or South America or even Asia are very, very small, and you can barely see them. The bottom panel shows you forest depletion, water depletion, and rain volume. As you can see, forest depletion and water depletion for India, it's bulging. It's really bulging. That means we are taking away a lot more than we can providing back. And although you must have heard that the Amazon forest is, you know, being destroyed and all that, but you can see Brazil. It's a really small map, because it's not getting depleted without replacement. So these are fun things you can do with cartography. And here's a very nice picture of our dear old Panjim, done in a very nicely friendly way, where you can artistically pleasing to the eye. So you can do wonders with cartography. Next, we come to global positioning systems, or GPS. So GPS consists of a constellation of satellites of about 24 active and actually 36 satellites, which are continuously revolving around the Earth. And at any given point of time, the GPS that you have in your phone or in your instrument is just a receiver receiving from these satellites. And it tells you the exact location of where you are on this Earth. And this can be used in many different ways. It can be used in camera traps, in tracking of wildlife. And I'll show you a few examples of it. So just to summarize, all these are different tools and methods in in the use of geospatial technology. So you use a computer and a mouse, and you do different kinds of analysis. You do satellite data analysis for mapping the land cover, mangroves, etc. You do geographical data analysis, which can include textual data or tables, which are like census tables, like population or something like that, and the spatial data. And then you can do statistical analysis with images. You can do cartography or map making. And nowadays, there are also a number of online resources, which are you can just put in the data and it'll do the processing and analysis for you. And I've listed a few open source software which are easy to use and available. If you have a little bit of training, you can use these software and do GIS yourself. Google Earth is also an open source software which many of you may have already used for doing your work, or locating something, but you don't really know that you're using very high-end geospatial technology, which is at the back of this. Geospatial data can be used to answer five different types of questions. The first type is what question. It is, you can answer a question which says, what exists at a particular location? For example, here's a forest type map. So you can say, what type of forest exists exists in Goa or exists in this particular location? So using GIS, you can see that. So this is a what question. The next type is a where question. So a where question is the converse of the first. That means you can ask a question like, find a location where some conditions are satisfied. For example, you can find a location which is a forest, which is at least 200 square kilometers, which is at least 1 kilometer away from any major road or railway or something, and which has a forest type which is suitable for a particular species, a bird species, say for a hornbill, for example. So you can combine all these conditions and ask a question, and the GIS will give you the answer of where you can locate this. The third type of question is a pattern over space question. For example, you can ask a question like, there's hunting happening in our protected areas. So is it happening more near the settlements, or is it happening far more inside the remote forest, or questions like that? So you can ask a question of how it is happening over space. The fourth type of question is a trends question, which is pattern over time. That means you can ask a question of what has happened over time. How much of mangrove land, for example, has been converted from urban to other land uses? And the fifth question is a what if question. That means it's a scenario modeling question. So for example, if a new road is built in a protected area, then you can model and see a scene of what are the effects it would have on, say, slopes, water resources, wildlife, how much of land will be lost, where will it go, those kinds of questions. So it would require both geographic and other information.
I'd like to pause, Madhura, I'd like to pause you
okay
for a little while, because over here I have one more question to add to those five questions.
Okay.
These questions that you said and this entire data, is this relevant to our mapping the MOLLEM situation, and how can that be used?
Yeah, that's a good question. Actually, it is relevant because this is a very easy. This could be a tool used for the MOLLEM question, because you can use the GIS, as in, you know, all these technology, the satellite map, and put all this. If you have enough data from the ground, you can put it into a system and visualize where the effects will be, how far the effects will be. You can create buffers along the railway line or the road, and you can actually see how far the impact is going to be. So there, we could use this kind of a scenario modeling situation, and for mitigation of for this kind of question. So yes, that's a good question. Yes, you could do scenario modeling. So going forward, I want to show you a few examples.
Can you share your screen again, please?
Okay, wait, I'm not able to see. So GIS or geospatial technology offers these, I mean, we've just seen so many possibilities, land cover mapping, land cover change mapping. You can do hazard mapping, do like fires or floods. You can do shoreline change mapping, especially in Goa. You know, you can do coastal CRZ violation studies or things like that. You can do agricultural applications and several of these applications. For wildlife, you can do map their habitats depending on certain conditions that are required for a particular species. You can do occupancy surveys for estimating the populations of wildlife using camera traps and locations based on those camera traps. You can estimate the populations, like how they are doing nowadays for tigers across the country. You can do niche modeling. That means you can do predictive mapping for where particular species may occur, or where if a species is very rare, then you can look at where it is possible to occur and create some conservation reserves for that. So this kind of predictive mapping is also possible. And of course, if you have GPS and the tracking locations of any wildlife, you can map their migration. And I've just left it open, there are many more that whatever you can imagine, you can possibly do with GIS if you know how to use the technology. I'm going to show you a few examples. So here is an example of mapping an invasive plant species, Lantana camara. This is what this is work that I had done for my PhD, and also a colleague who did work on mapping Lantana. The picture on the left shows you the spread of Lantana from over 10 years, and you can see how much it has grown. You can quantify it in the picture. And the one on the right shows the satellite picture and a map derived from the satellite picture. The satellite is on the right and the map is on the left. Then you can also do things like identifying zones of influence of a project. This is a site location for a windmill somewhere in southern Maharashtra. And these are the elevation zones over there. So we looked at the elevation zones, and the people, they had collected some ground information on plants, on birds, and they had run some transects there. And then we did a studies of the zones of influence of those windmills at 200 meters, 500 meters, or a kilometer away from the windmills, and looked at whether it's going to affect any of the wildlife there. Here's another example of fire occurrence. So hazards mapping you can do. And this is a tiger reserve in southern Western Ghats. And you're looking at different years of fire mapping, and you can the blue dots are the tribal settlements, so you can see how close the fires have come to these locations. And this kind of studies are also possible, and these can be used for managing the different locations by the forest department. Here's an interesting study which was done on a geotagged bar-headed geese are a bird species. Sorry, I don't have a picture, but you could look it up. These are locations for four bar-headed geese which were geotagged with a GPS on collar. And this picture is from a wildlife sanctuary in Uttar Pradesh where they were found in their wintering area, in the winter season. And this is their breeding ground. So you can see the flyway where they are breeding somewhere in Tibet. So this is all possible because of geotagging and geospatial technology. And here's, I think many of you may already be aware of the Amur falcon study, which is, Amur falcon is a falcon found in, passes through India on its migratory route to Africa from somewhere, you know, on east, in the eastern China, China area. And these three Amur falcons were tagged in Nagaland. And this map is showing their first season of migration. And you can see how much they have traveled all across India and across the Arabian Sea down south towards Africa. And that's where they have their wintering range. And then further from here, they were also tagged, mapped, returning back into India across and back, going back to their breeding range. So this is really amazing, amazing work that can be done using geospatial technology. So there's a lot of possibility from this, and
I would actually like to interrupt you there, but yeah. Do you think this technology can then be simplified to be used by anyone and everyone, and how can we do that?
Yeah, so I was just heading to that to show you something about citizen science. Geospatial technology is being leveraged very well by something called citizen science. So citizen science is community science or crowd science, crowdsourced science, in which scientific research is conducted by a bunch of people, the crowd data, which is collected by the community. So how does it work? You basically, you just take your phone, smartphones, and you take pictures of wildlife or whatever you see around you, and you upload it to certain websites, and all of that becomes data for a scientist to do scientific research. And so it becomes location records. And so how is it different from regular science which has been conducted till now is that earlier, or regular science, it involves the scientist and the scientist's lab, and those are the people who actually go out and collect field data, they do the processing, they design the project, and they, it is either an experiment or a hypothesis or something on which they build and they collect the data. But citizen science enables each and every one of us to contribute to projects like this. And there are several websites which allow this kind of collection of data on wildlife. And you can upload it to websites, and amazing results have come from it. And I'll show you just a couple of results. If some of you are bird watchers, you may know about eBird. eBird is a website on which you can upload your bird observations. And this year in 2020, they have come up with something called State of India's Birds and Atlas. And it's amazing. It's an amazing report. And I'll just show you two examples from that. Here is a map of the great hornbill, which is a bird seen only in the Western Ghats and particular forests of India. And as you can see, because they were geotagged, you can see where the distribution of this particular bird is. And if you look at it over time, they have actually been able to see how the decline, it has declined in numbers in the recent years. And here's another example of a bird called the rusty-tailed flycatcher. And in this, you can see the colors which indicate the different times of the year where it is seen abundantly. So you can see the seasonal migration of this bird. And it is just because citizens have actually taken pictures and uploaded it recorded it as in their bird lists. And it's gone into the atlas. So it's very interesting. Then there is a website called Season Watch, where people have done phenological studies. That means monitoring the flowering of mangoes. And looking at the trends over time, they have found that that climate change is real. There is evidence for climate change by looking at how the mango flowering happens across the country. There are several examples of this. There's another one in Kerala where people were engaged to count the fishes in a freshwater lake called Vembanad Lake. And across around the lake, people participated in a fish count, and they were themselves able to map their own resources, which is fish. We have a lot of information like this. We have butterfly counts, moth counts. And a couple examples I'd like to talk about are for conservation action. So in Thiruvannamalai area in Tamil Nadu, there is a hill called Arunachala Hill, and there was some litigation happening over there for a particular component of the hill. And there is a school there where the school children have been monitoring the birds and all the biodiversity of the area. And all of this data was actually used by the local people to inspire, stop this litigation and allow the hill to remain green and stop development. Similarly, Marine Life of Mumbai is an initiative started by some citizen scientists, and they are actually just documenting the intertidal biodiversity in the area. And it has been used very recently in the High Court as evidence for proving that there is a lot of biodiversity that is at stake if the transport expansion happens in northern Mumbai. So we are actually contributing to science, which can help in conservation. So here are some citizen science projects we can contribute to. There's eBird, there's India Biodiversity Portal, there's iNaturalist, and a bunch of these are all where you can contribute pictures and locations. And here are a bunch which are just for simple things like, road kills, or this is really like conservation. There is Owls of India, there is Tiger Watch. So a lot of citizens are contributing to these kinds of things. So we really have the power. And so I'd like to end with this cartoon showing the Australasian flyway. And I'll give you a few seconds to read. So basically, if the flyway and the leader of the pilot of the flyway is actually telling them that this is the traditional flyway which they have been using for so many hundreds of years, but because of the habitat destruction and the kind of changes that humans are bringing about in the landscape, their mapping systems in their head will be warped. So he's saying that, expect some turbulence, large scale habitat destruction. And so the maps in their heads are changing. So we should enable ourselves by using maps for their conservation. That's the message I'd like to send across to the audience, whoever is listening. And you're welcome to ask questions if you have any. Thank you.
Sure. My first question actually after this would be, how, when this technology, if it's available through citizen science to everyone, is it expensive to use, or are people investing in it? What kind of support would scientists need in terms of funding, and how does that happen?
So actually, it's expensive to use only if for the training part. So if you are, if you're getting a course, if you're taking a course, you're learning, studying about it. One second. Then it is expensive, but now everything is available. You just need a computer, and which is not so expensive nowadays, or pretty much many people have computers. Or if you want to contribute to GIS, to conservation science, then you use your smartphone. You can also do GIS on your smartphones nowadays. And there are a lot of open source software, so you don't have to invest in software or anything like that. You can download it from the web and just go ahead and do your stuff. It's not expensive at all.
That's great. Because from yesterday's session, there were a lot of young people who were looking at getting involved in such projects, or they really didn't have the avenue or the direction where they could do this. Furthermore to that, actually, not just at volunteering levels, how can one start a career in this, and what direction should people choose from a younger age to take this path ahead?
Okay, so choosing a career here, you would, the straight path would be to study geography or to study any of the sciences, natural sciences like biology and things like that, and then do a course in remote sensing, satellite image mapping, or GIS, geospatial technology. In Goa, Chowgule College offers a master's course, and you can enroll for that course. There are also several online courses now, or now everything has gone online since Corona happened. But a lot of courses are available where you can enroll and learn slowly, step by step. They give you assignments and things, and you can learn. But the most important thing is to understand the technology and see how it is applied. So it's also, everything is hands-on. So the more you do, the more you will learn.
There are actually a few requests to show the last few slides from where they can do the citizen science, as in the different avenues that we have. Even though this is a live session and they can go back, that a few references, that would be great if you can show those slides for some time.
Okay. I'll the citizen science ones.
Yes. So okay. Another question I had was, while working for citizen science or through geospatial mappings for other institutes, what kind of challenges have you faced, or what is the career once you have entered this, what are the kind of challenges that you would face?
Challenges really, today we don't really, the software was a challenge initially when I started several years ago. Software was all proprietary software, and technology was not so advanced, slow processing, satellite image processing was slow, but now all of that is gone. So you don't really have those challenges. Challenges today, especially for India, are data. Satellite data, freely, there are a lot of freely available data, but ground data, like, like if you want to measure river water flow, or you want to measure temperatures across a particular district, you don't have enough weather stations, you don't have enough ground information on wildlife monitoring or things like that. So ground data, getting that is difficult. Once you have data, you can do all kinds of amazing things with this technology software. So it's also important that when you design a project, you actually design how you will collect the field data, what you would require for providing that analysis. And so getting data is a big challenge. That's why citizen science is so important, because you are doing locating these wildlife and amazing things across the country, and you can do analysis in GIS sitting in your house. There's a citizen science conference which just recently concluded on the 1st, and there were some interesting projects on monitoring rainwater in the city of Pune. So there were this guy made this rainwater collection instrument, and he put it out there that whoever is interested join this project, and there were some 81 people who agreed to join him, and they collected data over the whole monsoon period and there is now, there you are, there's a lot of data. So that's the challenge, getting data and to be able to process it.
Coming back to one of the questions that we handled earlier, one of our listeners, Ishani Kosame, is asking, can the conservation action help stop Molem project? How would you like to answer that?
Good question. If we have enough information and it's presented properly and it is analyzed properly, we could present it to the people and to the forest department, and we could all come to a collective decision on whether it is good or bad. It's the information that should be out there, and a proper analytical study that should be out there. Only then we can evaluate between this and the other. So geospatial technology can help, but it can only help and tell you that these are the possibilities. Decision making really lies with the department and the people.
How can people contribute now, as we know, currently in Molem project there were EIAs which were already done, and so the current phase is a little bit different than what it was earlier. How would you say that people can gain a little bit of data and collect it now at this stage?
What you could do is actually go out there and map the wildlife that is there. I mean, you could contribute to citizen science projects and right now go and show that there are rare species or threatened species that are birds, butterflies, which are being actually recorded from those locations, and see that indicate that those are wildlife that one needs to conserve, and they are found right where these projects are passing through. So because the EIAs which have been done, are some of them are out in the public domain, not everything is out there, and they have been conducted by experts. But if we have more and more information, the more information is there, the more we are able to empower the process of decision making on this. So right now that's what you can do, and once that all that data is there, then analysis and all will be the next few steps, but that's what you can do.
We have a question from Svetlana Pinto. She's asking, the Department of Animal and Veterinary Services tagged farm animals and sometimes domestic pets who are being transported abroad. Does this have anything to do with the technology that you have mentioned today?
Not that I can think of, not really. I mean, it's not tagging them or anything like that, no. But yeah, I mean, if you have farm animals which have that RFID in them, and then you identify where they go. In the US, each and every animal which is farmed for beef, for cattle, beef or pork or whatever, they all have RFIDs, and they from their birth they know which farm they are grown in, and you know, that kind of thing. So spatial information is there, but we don't have that, and we don't really need it for anything. So veterinary sciences, if there are more studies happening, I'm not aware of it, but yeah, but that's the veterinary question.
Well, I have a question from Karishma Naik. It's a, you decide how you want to answer that. Do birds follow magnetic field of the earth while migrating?
Yes and no. They do follow a magnetic, because they have some kind of a map in their heads, and they have some kind of a magnetic system. I guess there must be a lot of research happening for this, but we don't really know the exact reason for why they follow certain pathways and certain what is the exact answer to this question. Although a lot of research is happening, and they amazing things they have done. You know, some wagtails which migrate down south to India from up in the Himalayas, they have been research has found that some wagtails who have been ringed or tagged have actually come back and landed in the same, you know, 10 square meter plot where they were tagged earlier. Not even the same lake or the same 10 square meter plot where they have where they were ringed. So they really must have something in their head, which is a GPS and an app.
I'm glad from this question we actually reached not just a technology that humans have created, but the initial technology that has been there in wildlife for such a long time, and you know, humans are just catching up right now, and they didn't have this. So I have another question from Siddhi. India is still to prepare ground database, which is a laborious task. But has the data compiled till now for private individual projects, for example, for your project, made available to public?
My project is mine was the one that I spoke to you about was a PhD study, and so it's there in my thesis. It's out for anyone to read or see the data. In India, we have a lot of global data sets which are open, which can be used for India. Like there is something called OpenStreetMap, which maps out the every street, every corner, every building, you know, and river and everything. And OpenStreetMap is a very good resource. You can go to the website and see. It is a good resource for data. So that is possible. For many private projects, like research projects, they don't have the data out there. They have the reports or the research papers published. But in recent years, in the last 5-8 years or so, or maybe more, it has become a trend to actually put the data also out there. So if I do some research and publish a paper with it and some analysis, I also put the data out there. So somebody else could use the same data and produce some other more interesting outcomes or approach, take a different approach and do different kinds of analysis. So several journals and research initiatives are now insisting on putting the data also, making it available for people to use. And so I could use it differently, you could use it differently and produce different results. Yeah. To answer different questions.
That's really great. I would like to point out to everyone who's listening, not just the citizen science projects, but there are a lot of avenues which are available out in the open, and including our NGOs who are working with us now, and we would like to point you out in the right direction, whether it is Global Shapers or any of the contacts that we are going to share with you at the end of this presentation. You can contact any of them and they would definitely like to guide you in the direction that you are genuinely interested in. We have another question from Svetlana Pinto. Unfortunately, the government is known for starting great ventures with good intentions, but eventually due to lack of maintenance, these systems very often fail. Could you give examples of the systems that you have mentioned being used today by the government of Goa, or are there more popular in private organizations working with conservation?
I don't really understand what she means by systems here.
It could be a website that might fail, or similar to some app or something that has been used, which would then lead to wildlife conservation. That's what I think I'm getting from the question. Madhura, can you hear me?
Yeah, can you hear me? I can hear you.
No, I think there was a little lag.
Yeah.
Can you answer that again?
Yeah, no, I was saying that I'm not sure I really understand the question, but from there, Goa government, I don't know if I really understand the question in the terms of systems which fail. Goa government has not been directly using GIS, I don't think so, but they are using mapping technology. In Forest Department has been using mapping technology and doing several things. So it must be used. It is being used.
You can stop the presentation. I think that's not enough time for everyone to see.
Yeah,
the list of citizen science, and you can definitely, these are the projects which are happening in India, but there are projects in the wildlife conservation sector which are happening worldwide, and you can definitely go and just search for citizen science projects on Google itself and then get a lot of data as well as opportunities to work with them. We have a question from Karishma Naik, and she's asking, why do birds undertake migration even though they are homeotherms? I'm sorry, I'm not
from birds. Yeah, birds are homeotherms, and actually I don't think I'm I should be answering this question because I'm not qualified to answer this question, and I'm sure you have a talk on birds coming up in this week. They are warm-blooded and they need to migrate to warmer regions during extreme cold winters. Wherever they live, or during the winters, they have to migrate to find food. And you can read up on this. There's very interesting studies happening. The Amur falcon is a great example. The barheaded geese are good examples. India is a large area where these kinds of winter migrations happen, of Himalayan birds which live in the Himalayas and come down south during the winters. Our own Goa, you will see now is the time, October, November, up to February, you will see amazing diversity of forest species also, which suddenly the numbers increase. You can look at eBird data and you can see how the numbers of birding lists increase, and migration has happens because they're looking for food and there isn't enough where they are. And I'm sure this question can be posed to Omkar also when he does his talk.
Yes, Karishma, I would like to request you to please join us on 8th October that is our last session with Omkar, and he's a bird expert in Goa. So you can definitely pose this question and more questions that you have about birds to him. We have an explanation from Svetlana. She meant that you have spoken about drones, maps, and GIS, etc. Are these being successfully used either by government of Goa or in private sector? And if there are any such examples?
Yes, private sector definitely using maps, GIS, GPS. Architectural firms are using a lot of maps, the government is. Drones are a very, very expensive technology as of today, because a small flight for a small area requires a lot of battery life, and the batteries are expensive. The drone itself, you can have a drone machine which will fly, but the batteries are expensive and they drain out like this. So that's why drone technology is expensive. So it's not being used so much. And the government of India had a lot of restrictions on how drones can be used, whether they can be used for mapping, especially in coastal areas like Goa, because sensitive information and all that. So they have been back and forth about giving permissions for drone mapping. Right now, as we speak, it is open. We can use drones for mapping, but there are several restrictions, so it is difficult. So government, to answer your question now that I understand what you're saying, drones are not being used. GIS maps outcomes are being used. I'm not aware if the software and the actual processing analysis technology is currently being used in any of the government departments, especially in Goa, I'm not aware of. But I'm sure it is possible. In many other states, it is being used. And many states across India, they have their own state remote sensing center. So they have their own state center where all this satellite data is downloaded, processed, mapping is done.
We have a question from Ishani. Like the map that you showed about the bulges, the cartographs, the forest depletion, about the forest depletion, can this technology tell us where there is most need of planting trees and where can we plant more saplings?
So the cartograms were actually, basically it is all data, and the maps which exist, the bulge is shown by the quantity of depletion or loss or increase or whatever. So if you have that kind of data from the ground, then depiction or creating those kinds of maps will be possible. But you have to have that kind of data from the ground. So you have to know where maximum trees are being cut and whether they are being replaced by plantation or not, or those kinds of things. So you have to, that's what I said when I said, what is the biggest challenge? We don't have enough data. If you have data, you can show these kinds of things. So basically, all that I talked about is really technology. So we entitled this talk as Geospatial Technology for Wildlife Conservation, right? So we are using a lot of technology. There is a lot of possibility, but it depends on how you decide to use and where is your original data coming from, how you process the data.
Nilesh Patil is asking us that he had read somewhere that this technique can also be used to detect plant diseases. If you have any idea about how it's done?
Yes, it can be helped. It can be used for detecting plant diseases. Right now in India, it can only be used in agricultural area. It has been used only, not so much in forests, because our forests are extremely diverse. We have a extremely biodiverse forest, and they are not monocultures, or like in coniferous regions or regions where there are one or two species only, you can detect the actual trees which have some kind of a moth infestation or some kind of disease, and they can be picked out from satellite data. But in India, in the forests, it's very difficult or almost not possible, unless there is a large area which has which has been affected, like a hazard by fire or something, or a pest. So pest infestation in agriculture is possible, but not in not in forests, not in India.
This is actually making me realize that the infestation that happened very recently, and it had spread in Madhya Pradesh and all those areas. And I can see the lack of technology, use of technology rather, that is happening in India. This lecture, I hope, inspires a lot of people to join and develop this site, because there are so many people who are now getting current with technology that is available everywhere and is being developed. One more thing I would like to remind everyone, please go back if you joined a little late during the presentation. one aspect that Madhura told us, which was important for this function to work, was using softwares, methods and hardware and data and people. So we have everything that is available, and the main thing that we require is people to do this. So you can definitely go back and check out everything. The time is running out, and there's one question that I would like to... Oh, there's one more question from our own technical support. So Sushrut and Raisa, mine and Niroshka's siblings, are helping us with the technical support. And he has a question, can this mapping be used to monitor or rather prevent forest fires by checking large areas of dry grassland, and what measures can be taken after detection?
Yes, fire mapping is a huge, very highly advanced research has happened in fire mapping, fire prediction, fire monitoring over time, and in other countries definitely so. In our country, a little, not so much. But we have, especially in Uttarakhand and the Himalayan hill slopes, a lot of fire mapping monitoring does happen. It is possible, like you're saying, you know, checking large areas of dry grasslands, yes, but you have to continuously monitor. So you know a particular area is prone to fire, then you have to map it out how like in our country, like April, May are the dry seasons. A lot of fire monitoring is happening in Karnataka. The Karnataka Forest Department has a special cell which is actually doing satellite image monitoring. Every 15 days they have, or even maybe the frequency is even more. I have a friend who works there, and they actually monitor the fire season really, really closely, because fires are a big hazard there. So it is possible, yeah. And if we just invest a little bit more time and into actually identifying these locations where it's possible, yes, it's done.
That does make me wonder, though, that why was it not used in Australia, or whether it was used in that actually shows a little bit of failure on our part, that if this was already detected and whether it could have been avoided, the huge fires that are currently happening in America and Australia when it did.
Yeah, they must be monitored, but the rate of spread of the fire is so fast that, you know, by the time you take a picture and you map it out, and then they definitely are mapping. There is a lot of stuff happening there. I've been part of some of the fire mapping monitoring in the US also when I was in California. It is amazing work, and it is 24/7. It's just continuously data is coming in, and you're processing it, and you're looking where the fire line is, the line of control as it moves, as the fire moves. So it's fantastic work. I mean, very challenging, very fun, fun to for the technology person, but not so much fun for the firefighters. Yeah, but you're giving hands-on information as it happens.
Oh, Veloisa Mascarenas has asked, how are plant species identified using the technology as shown in one of the slides? Some characteristic signature is identified, or how is it done?
Yes, so species level mapping is now possible for some species in India, but as I said, you know, the forest is so complex that every species is not identifiable, but some species or some types of forest you can identify because they have a particular signature. The satellite takes a picture, and a few particular species have only a particular way of behaving they can be detected by certain their reflections in the electromagnetic spectrum. So that is detected, and their specific signature is identified, and then they can be mapped.
That's great. If there are any more questions, please refer to our the slide at the end that we are going to show. There's one last question that I would like to ask you about. How would you advice to today's generation who are eager to be part of this high priority undertaking?
Well, get trained if you're interested in geospatial technology. Start doing stuff yourself. Download the data, download software. There are lots of open source software. Take courses online. And I would suggest don't do it just offhand, but take a short course or something and start working on it, because the more you do, the more you learn. It's like it's a tool, it's like a language. The more you use it, the better you get at it. So start doing. Yeah, in Goa, we have actually have the Chowgule College offering the master's course. We also have a college in Keppe, I'm not sure, but there are courses available in the formal education system. So, and do citizen science. You will see the results of your mapping immediately.
While our technical support shows the contact information of everyone involved in this, I would like to thank you, Madhura, for taking this time out and sharing your knowledge with us. I'm sure there is so much more to learn for everyone. And I myself have so many things which I want to ask and, you know, have this conversation again. But I'm sure, like everyone else, I'll be able to get some time and do this at some other point. But I would also like to thank Global Shapers, this entire hub who has supported us, and it's going to be doing the same thing for another 6 days. FERC and SAVE GBCN have also been great part, and I would love to know more about FERC, its work. The contacts are on your screen. Please go ahead and feel free to get in touch. And as the week progresses, I'm sure many of your questions will be answered in different aspects as well. Thank you so much once again, Madhura.
Thank you, Manmayi. Thank you to Global Shapers for giving me this opportunity. And I hope it inspires some of the students or even any other people who are interested to find out more and participate in this. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you. Bye.